Good morning. It's the 8th of April, 1993. For the Heritage Group of IATSA 659, this is Jay Nefcy. I'm here with Howie Block and Bob Feller. And today, we're at the home of the distinguished cinematographer, Mr. Dean Cundey. Morning, Dean. How are you?
Good morning. Fine this morning.
Yeah? Thank you for allowing us to come into your home and to be part of the Heritage Group's oral histories.
Thanks. I'm glad you guys could make it.
Oh, yeah. Well, you've always been a favorite of mine. We've been watching you for a long time doing terrific things. What we do with our oral histories, we usually start off with your early history, where you come from, and what sorts of backgrounds you have in terms of your education and that sort of thing. Where are you from, Dean?
Born and raised in Los Angeles, Alhambra.
Los Angeles guy. Yeah?
1946.
Mm-hmm.
And have lived here all of my life, actually.
Yeah? Where'd you go to school?
I went to high school in Alhambra. I went to Cal State University, Los Angeles for a couple of years, getting rid of my general education requirements, and then I graduated from the UCLA Film School.
Oh, so you did go to UCLA?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And what year did you get out of there?
In 68.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, before you went into film school, were you interested in motion pictures, still photography, that sort of thing? Were you a fan?
Yeah, I've been interested in film, theater, that kind of thing. I think for as long as I can remember, in high school, I was part of the plays and the theater.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid, I remember building little sets out of cardboard and painting them and so forth. My original intention was actually to be an art director.
Mm-hmm.
I was interested in set design. And throughout high school, I took some art classes and things like that. I remember in eighth grade writing we had to do a paper as part of learning how to write term papers in eighth grade. We had to choose a career that we thought we wanted to go into, interview various people in that area, and compile it and do a 5-page paper or something like that. I chose television directing.
Mm-hmm.
Interviewed various guys who did news and things like that. So I think my interest in this area has gone back, pretty much as far as I can remember. And then my family, my parents, never really discouraged me. They would always warn me that, it's a difficult kind of business to get into. It's not something that one can walk into as easily as one does accounting. My father was a salesman for Dun & Bradstreet. My mother was a housewife.
So they had nothing to do with the motion picture industry?
No,
per se.
Not really. And so they never discouraged me, but I remember my mother's warnings were, be sure you have some kind of a craft or trade or skill you can fall back on.
Uh-huh.
So I think when I was intending to be an art director, I also decided I would study architecture, because I had gone down to the set designers locally as part of this job term paper that I had done, and said, well, if I wanted to be an art director, what would I have to study? And they all said, oh, the best thing is architecture.
Hmm.
So I said, well, that sounds like a good fallback. So I had actually investigated going into A.S.C. School of Architecture or San Luis Obispo or some of the other, in getting a degree in that. And then as I began reading what you had to study, calculus and engineering and all of that kind of thing, realizing that was that was fine for architecture, but really wasn't related to what I wanted to do in my heart, which was film, I thought, well, maybe I'll do some of both. So I applied to film school. But while I was there, and while I was at Cal State LA, I took classes in graphics, in design, in all these various things, with the idea being that, and drafting, with the idea that if I needed to get a job, I would have some skills, even as a draftsman or whatever, and be able to work into
a straight job,
yeah,
that sort of thing, yeah.
So I, as a matter of fact, that in school, I worked in the summers and so forth as a drafts person, so I felt kind of that I, was fulfilling these.
Well, at the same time, what you were doing was getting quite a wide background, and not just in the camera.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if I really felt it at the time, but I realized now that a lot of the classes I took in design, in drafting, all of that stuff, really is applicable to what you do in this business, how you relate to production designers, and mm-hmm. how you relate to construction people, and how you relate to the graphic designers and all of those people. I never took a class I ever felt was not in some way useful to me. I took surveying. I took played in the band for years all throughout high school.
Well, music is a very good background for this business.
I played the saxophone all the way through college.
You and Bill can play duets then.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to having him invite me to a dinner at the White House and play saxophone with Bill Clinton. But the music, the ability to read music, relate to musicians and choreographers and all mm-hmm. that stuff, being able to read scores, all of the classes I took, I think, were valuable. Mm-hmm. And it's something when I talk to film students and all, they'll say, well, what classes do you take? And I say, well, take all kinds of stuff in all the creative areas, and also in, when you work with special effects people, you're dealing with engineering and mechanics and stuff like that. I mean, there's almost no kind of knowledge area that we don't use as camera people.
Music is feel and emotion, and that's what all the great cameramen gravitate towards, is trying to convey emotion to their photography.
Right, exactly.
But let's get back to the history part of things. At what point did you key into cinematography then? Was this still in college? You kind of decided.
Yeah, I was in my second year at UCLA.
Mm-hmm.
I was still taking, even at UCLA, I was taking architecturally oriented classes, and I, as I began working on projects, I worked as a cameraman on a student project, and I took a class that James Wong Howe taught.
What an inspiration.
It was probably one of the most significant classes, certainly one I had taken there, but that the school had given. They had somehow talked James Wong Howe into between The Heart is a Lonely Hunter and the Molly Maguires
mm-hmm.
into coming and teaching a class in cinematography. And actually Steve Burum was the teaching assistant, and he and I took the class together. And it was, to me, it was fascinating on one level, but also a kind of a turning point. We would build a little three-wall kind of empty set, and it had a window and a door and a table and a chair and a couch or something like that on one of the sound stages at UCLA. And he would show up, and we, about 20 or 30 people in the class, became the crew. And there would be a package of lighting stuff on the floor. And he would say, all right, the script tells us that this room is a shabby hotel room. How are we going to make it look like that? And he would go through the process of lighting this and creating the mood just with the lighting, because it was essentially an empty, plain room. But we became the crew and had to actually handle the lights. And it was one of the most practically oriented classes I had taken there too, because we had to learn what spotting and flooding and what the diffusion did and what the flags and all of the things that he was so used to using that as film students we never used,
mm-hmm.
He required us to use them as part of his technique. He was used to using that stuff. So we saw firsthand how you use flags and nets and so forth. And we it was valuable because I learned how to actually operate lighting equipment
mm-hmm.
and nets and flags. But beyond that, it also became an insight into how are you creative with just the lighting
mm-hmm.
And the camera angles. He said, block out a little scene and shoot a little something. And then he'd say, all right, we're done with that. We have to move on now. Now it's a fashionable boudoir from the 1700s. Mm. And we've now completely changed the look just with the lighting.
No change of set, no
right.
change of art direction.
Everything absolutely the same. And he would go through the thought process. We would use the lighting equipment. And then we would go outside and he would show us using, we had one of these very antiquated 170 arcs.
Mm-hmm.
What equipment we had, he showed us how to use it and also the creative process that went into it. Well, I realized that what I was interested in was creating the visuals
mm-hmm.
Of film, that I was interested in. It wasn't just the architecture, it wasn't the background, but it was how do you, you know, really tell a story visually. And I realized that, you know, the photography, the cinematography end of it was where you were kind of dynamically involved with that, as opposed to, you know, working on the drawing board and then being done with it. And that's where I decided that what I really wanted to do was the cinematography. So at that point, sort of changed my focus, no pun intended, to the cinematography.
Mm-hmm.
And I began taking then more of the classes that were oriented in that area.
Well, this James Wong Howe has been an inspiration to a lot of us. I mean, George Deeby, he worked with George Deeby, John Lonzo, obviously yourself. And his name keeps popping up. I mean, it's,
mm-hmm.
it's been one of the men that's was generous and sharing his knowledge and
mm-hmm.
try to extend the ideas. So that's terrific that it's your background too, that it works for
you. Yeah. Well, and I think that's one of the things that I've kind of tried to do,
mm-hmm.
But I think, you know, is really important that we do is to, you know, spread our experience and knowledge by going to, you know, film schools, film students, inviting people who are up and coming over to see what it is we do and how we do it. I mean, you know, it's a very, it's something that's hard to sort of explain the value of, you know, because, you know, a lot of times film students, you know, are kind of stuck in an academic area and
mm-hmm.
they don't really get all of the practical information that we can provide. And I as much as possible, I like to try to do that kind of thing.
Well, we've got you in your history now. You got you in college. You
mm-hmm.
graduate then in what year was it?
'68.
Geez, things were happening in Los Angeles then. It was the tail end of the wild 60s and the middle of, I mean, actually things didn't start happening until the late 60s, so there's the middle of all the stuff going on.
Right.
And you came out of college. What'd you do?
Let's pause for just a moment.
Okay. Yeah, we're rolling. So that was the interruption for the gardeners. They're going to take a long lunch or something.
Just to make sure that I'm not obscured for posterity by the sound of a blower.
All right, so we had you in 1968 getting out of college, and your newly minted electrician, cameraman. How did you see yourself at that point?
Well, it was actually kind of an interesting period, I think, in the industry, at least, you know, as I saw it. I had come through the height of the 60s, the you know, absolutely true flower child hippie period.
Were you a hippie?
No, as a matter of fact, I was one of those, I saw myself as kind of an in-between.
Uh-huh.
I know that, you know, I had friends who were, you know, actual, real, genuine hippies.
Mm-hmm.
There were guys in the film school who always wore a coat and tie.
Mm-hmm.
You knew that they were going to become producers. and I was somewhere in between.
Well, Jim Morrison was around there at the time, wasn't he?
Yeah, he had graduated, I think, about a year or two before me,
mm-hmm.
and or it was out at least. And Francis Coppola was just before
mm-hmm.
Myself. So I kind of, you know, observed, you know, both sides of it, but I was never really, you know, part of that you know, that really very interesting
mm-hmm.
sort of cultural period.
Did you photograph any of it? Did you get involved in it?
No, I don't think so. I mostly observed it.
We were talking about Primes. He seemed to really get into the scene in San Francisco and was one. Mm-hmm. He was hanging out with Kesey and all that stuff, and and Richard Edlund, of course, he was a hipster.
Right.
And it's kind of interesting aside.
Yeah, but that period was also the period when Hollywood was, you know, kind of reacting to that. They saw. I mean, there were films obviously made
Easy Rider
about
the time,
the
yeah.
period, and also there was kind of a thing where Hollywood was looking for the new young director, and,
mm-hmm.
Francis Coppola had just made You're a Big Boy Now, and so the studios were saying, oh, maybe there's these new hot young guys that are going to be the way of the future, there was kind of this optimistic feeling among film students and new people that you know, there were going to be opportunities, you know, because prior to that it was very difficult to get into.
Mm-hmm.
Subsequent to that, it also became difficult. But you know, so I think I kind of came out at a good time when there was a little, you know, kind of an optimistic feeling about being able to, you know, become a part of the
mm-hmm.
film industry. So, I...
Oh, it went off. Howie, we lost that light again. Okay, one small change here. You don't have a backlight. You were rolling?
Yeah.
Now we've got our backlight again. I apologize.
Good.
I promise it won't screw up again. Dumb thing. All right, so we have you... out about, and you trying to make a living? Did you go?
Yeah, I, again, in one of those fortunate instances, I had worked on a couple of projects with some guys at school, and had done makeup on a project, one of the student films.
Mm-hmm.
And when we all sort of graduated the same year, there were three of the guys had gone to Roger Corman and had written a script, and they had convinced Roger to finance a low-budget feature.
Oh, great.
It was a motorcycle-oriented film, which was...
He did a lot of those.
I think it was probably one of the last of that kind of
mm-hmm.
Cycle, again, no pun intended, of films. And when they convinced Corman to finance this thing, they wisely went around to as many of their UCLA friends as they could and said, you want to work on a movie? And I had done the makeup on one of the films, and they said, you know, would I be interested in doing makeup? Well, it was an actual job on a real movie, and I said, well, of course. So it was actually quite an adventure. You know, we were on location and we were shot in LA, and you know, we were all learning about making films, and so I you know, did some prosthetic scars and all this kind of thing that I had kind of done at school, and even in high school I had played around with makeup. So we made that film, it was also I had just gotten married also, just as we had graduated from school.
Mm-hmm.
We had moved into an apartment, my wife Charlene and myself. And, you know, she was teaching school, and I went off and worked on this film. And when that was completed, I came back, and I thought to myself, now what's the next step? How do I get a job? And I was home for about probably 3 or 4 days thinking about how I was going to do this. And the phone rang, and it was Roger Corman himself, and he asked me if I wanted to do makeup on a film that he was directing. And I said, well, sure. So I hung up the phone. I said, well, this is great. You graduate from film school, and then people just call you on the phone all the time and offer you work. I said, this is going to be so a lot easier than I was told. So I then did makeup on Gas, which was one of the last films that Roger directed. That was, you know, another interesting, you know, experience in learning how filmmaking, watching him work and watching all these various people. And then when that was over, I went home and I sat down next to the phone and said, well, I wonder who's going to be next. And it was nobody. They, suddenly was faced with the actual reality, which was, you know, they don't always call. So I then said, well, how am I going to get work? Well, fortunately, my wife was working, and she was supporting us through this, and was in fact encouraging me to kind of pursue this dream. So I then began looking around, and I did all kinds of little odd jobs, editing on something, and some special effects, helping something else, and then I...
tapping into your network of friends from UCLA.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, what I began to realize, which is something that's true in the industry, is that a lot of it is networking.
Mm-hmm.
That, who you've worked with and who you've come in contact with and how well you've worked with them, how good a job you did, are all parts of how, you get your next job and how you continue your career. Somebody would call up and they say, hey, I just got, a job. Somebody from the Corman organization would call me and say, well, we need two shots to fill in inserts for this film. Can you shoot them? And I would, go off and rent a camera and shoot some inserts or something.
So by this time, you've talked him into letting you handle the camera. And
yeah, I had had been working. I had done some gaffing and some lighting for somebody, and he, the guy would say, "Well, I can't do it, but why don't you let he would recommend me or whatever." So it became a case of doing all kinds of little odd jobs that actually was again part of my education. I think that when you come out of film school, at least when I came out of film school, what you've learned is all of the things you're going to have to learn.
Just the introduction to it.
Exactly. You get some sense of the skills and techniques and things that are used in making film, and you now realize the things you're going to have to learn in order to do that. So I began working at all these odd jobs, now starting to learn the practical aspects of all this this filmmaking. So I went from just kind of odd job to odd job, and at one point I finally said, "Well, I wonder now how can I cut to the chase? How can I now focus what I'm going to do?" Just prior to that, Fuad Said had built the first cinemobile, the small one that was being used on I-Spy. I saw a picture of that, and having worked on low-budget films and having seen a truck that Francis Coppola had built for Rain People, which was a van compartmentalized, I said, there is a possible solution. So I bought a Dodge van, a large van, and along with three friends, we built compartments, cut extra doors in it, put in wooden compartments and so forth, put in a generator, and I built the movie van.
Oh, terrific!
Which was you might say kind of a lower tech version of a cinemobile.
Yeah.
But it still had extra doors, doors on both sides and doors in the back, dedicated compartments that were designed specifically for pieces of equipment.
And you acquired equipment to put in it?
Then I went out and I leased, with help from my father, I leased a package of equipment.
Mm-hmm.
And carried three Aries, two blimps, all of the camera stuff, zoom lenses and so forth, sound equipment, 30-some lights,
mm-hmm.
Of all sizes up to 2K, two xenon lights, reflectors, grip equipment, apple boxes, sandbags, essentially all of the nucleus of things that you need for making a film. The idea being that I would rent the equipment and myself out, and along with this, you know, crew of guys that I'd put together, and we would then go out and try to promote ourselves into work. And it actually, I think, was successful from that standpoint, because I would take it around to assorted producers and
sure.
show them the package, and of course, it became appealing to them because it was a one-stop shopping kind of situation, where they didn't have to deal with ordering equipment and all that stuff. You know, it was all sort of taken care of for them. And I had gone to various cameramen, because at that point I was, you know, still kind of working as a gaffer or whatever I could do. And they used that as a an appealing thing to get themselves work also. They would go to the producer and say, I can package the whole crew and equipment. So one day, we were scheduled to do a one-week repair job on a feature for Herb Strock, who is an editor and a director who had worked for years in Warner Brothers during the heyday of television there, Maverick and the Roaring Twenties and all of those shows. And he kind of specialized in repairing features, fixing them up, getting shows that had story problems and so forth. And he had hired another cameraman and myself as the gaffer and this whole equipment package, and we were going to start, you know, the next week or whatever. So I went to him a day or two before to get the call and get the information. Walked into his office just as he slammed down the phone and said, now what am I going to do? And I said, what do you mean, Herb? And he said, well, the cameraman just quit. I can't believe he's so unprofessional. He took a better job. And I said, oh, no, that's awful, Herb. I have some film out in the car.
Let me show it to you.
Let me show it to you. So I ran out and I brought in some stuff I'd been shooting, and he said, all right, I guess I don't have a choice. And so I ended up as the director of photography on this little one-week job. But apparently it worked out, because he said, hey, I'm doing another one in 2 weeks. Can you do the same thing? And then the production manager on those two shows was then going to become the production manager on a feature.
Well, they must have been happy with you, because they just saved their butt, you know.
Well, yeah, we, you know, it was one of those things where you, you know, again, something that I've kind of felt, which is you try to always do a better job than they expect,
mm-hmm.
deliver more than you promise. So, I mean, we worked like 20-hour days and long hours, you know, but doing, you know, a good job. Well, the production manager in that show became the production manager on a actual full feature, and he talked the producers into hiring me as the director of photography along with the
Marvelous.
Equipment package and so forth. So I was then on my way to acquiring some credits and experience and credibility as a cameraman. And I began then working in low-budget features using the van for
Excellent.
Some time. I did, I don't know, 25 or 30 features, you know, in the non-union low-budget area.
So just to be clear about it, you did this in about 2 years after graduating from college. So you're...
Yeah, I built the van in 72.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I started, you know, kind of, it was about 73 that I began, you know, really working consistently as a director of photography. Consistently being, of course, 2 or 3 weeks here, and then a month
sure.
4 weeks here, you know, but the 4 weeks was a long feature in those days.
Mm-hmm. But you had your equipment, you had, you know, pretty good time. What happens with just, you know, as to a lot of us, is that we really don't understand the business a lot, but being in Los Angeles and getting your degree and understand the business from those points of view, and you went right to the position you wanted to, which was cinematographer, at a fairly young age.
Yeah, I you know, people say, well, how long were you an operator? How long you were an assistant? Mm-hmm. And I guess I was kind of fortunate in that I started at the top, you might say.
Yeah.
You know, I was always my own operator.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I operated. You're always kind of your assistant.
Oh, yeah.
Know, because I, as a matter of fact, it's one of those first shows is where I met Ray Stella, who is...
Oh, you guys go back that far.
Oh, yes. Ray and I have been working 18 years, and he's, you know, still my operator. Ray showed up one day when I had the van, and he had never worked in the film before, but he convinced me that he had. then he ran off to a rental house to find out how you...
what you do? turn on the camera.
Well, you know, it was a learning process for all of us, and so I learned what assistants have to know. I worked as an operator, you know, because that's all mm-hmm. important. You don't really ever start at the top. But I was fortunate in that, you know, I was able to start learning the cinematography part of it, the lighting, the camera angles, working with directors and actors and all that stuff early on.
Well, also it was a very smart business move to have your own package so that you weren't always fuddling around trying to learn a new rig, trying to learn a new system all the time.
Kind of smart, although I never made any money at it. It was always just barely, you know, barely paid for itself,
mm-hmm.
you know, over a period of time. It was a case of always looking for another job. And I realized at that point, you know, what I really wanted to do was cinematography and not become an equipment rental person. And, you know, so I was always torn between, you know, trying to rent equipment out and you know, chisel somebody for a little more money, or wanting to get the job because I wanted to do the work. So I can't say that it was a necessarily smart financial business move, but as far as advancing
career move
my career
sure.
and so forth, I really think that it was you know, a significant
mm-hmm.
kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It allowed me to get the jobs that I probably would not have been able to do otherwise.
Yeah, and now that you're working right into the feature world, you didn't have to wade your way through, say, documentary or
mm-hmm.
commercial world, which a lot of people do, or video, and get reaching where you wanted to go and grasping it, and obviously hanging on to it. So you did well with it.
Yeah, I what's interesting is that by working in features, you know, you really learn all of the things that are necessary, and no matter what the show, I have very bizarre you know, films that I worked on.
Mm-hmm.
I don't regret really any of them.
Oh,
you know, no matter how bad. I mean, a lot of them were really just projector fodder for drive-in theaters and things like that. You know, action films, car wreck films, and
sure.
but it was always a case of learning something.
Mm-hmm.
I never did a job that I didn't try to learn something, even if it didn't look like there were opportunities. I would, you know, if nothing else, it was always 100,000 feet of film that somebody was paying for me to experiment with. And learning how to do it on a low budget with fewer lights, you know, than you really needed.
Mm-hmm.
Learning how to stage car chases and explosions and special effects. A lot of times with guys who are still themselves learning how to drive cars fast or set up explosions or whatever. You know, it was a case of everybody kind of learning and experimenting on their own. It really was, you know, you read the histories of a lot of the great directors, you know, William Wyler and all these people, and you realize that they worked for years in one reel, you know, things in silent
mm-hmm.
films and B-movies and all kinds of things before they became these overnight successes.
Oh, yeah.
With one film. And, you know, Frank Capra, for instance, was that way. Well, for me, the low-budget non-union films were the B-films, the one-reelers, the things where you learn before you actually have to go out and do something that either expensive or significant.
Well, and not only that, but the people you were working with all went on to significant other projects that then they'd say, oh, geez, I worked well with Dean mm-hmm. before, let's give him another shot, that kind of thing. And that has to help.
Oh, yeah.
That has to, and yeah. It was all like Los Angeles, you know, as opposed to, as they do in Denver or,
right.
or Austin or any of the, or, you know, whoever, Detroit or anything like that, to get
right.
to come here to the Hollywood. That's great. Mm-hmm. But y'all, and not only that, you were still under 30. I mean, this is a,
mm-hmm.
you know, cinematographers' careers go to, well, Joe Byrock is 80s and,
mm-hmm.
and still working. So your career was really taken off at a pretty young age for
doing yes, that. I feel kind of fortunate from that standpoint that I was able to start early enough, you know, in an area that I wanted to do it,
mm-hmm.
right out of film school and the training, and then continue the training, the practical part of it,
in these low budget in this low budget area, so you get your skills down to the point where you really felt very, very confident.
Right.
Well, so you're doing these low budget films, and did you do those for what, 5 years or so, or more? Or?
Well, I guess the. I'm very bad with dates and
oh well,
things. My
approximately,
yeah,
is it? But for a period of time,
worked
the Roger Corman circuit, and
and I think one of the turning points was the film Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Little
horror thing,
right? And it was obviously it was a turning point for also John Carpenter and a lot of people involved. I was introduced to John, and he was going to do this. Low-budget film that he had hoped was somehow going to, you know, become a classic or whatever, and a case of everybody being at the right place at the right time. He said, you know, he would like me to shoot it, and because I'd showed him some film, and so we embarked on that in.
78 or
79.
Oh,
I
see. I
thought
that
filmography
right here.
Yes, I can't remember when it was. But the significance of that was it was a film
mm-hmm.
that became recognized.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a case of a film that we shot in 21 days, I believe. The cost was like $280,000 or so. And it went on to make millions and millions and millions
oh, yeah.
of dollars. Well, suddenly, your credibility goes up.
Oh, yeah.
Because you're now working on a film that everybody recognizes. But after that, I began getting phone calls because everybody who wanted to make a really successful low-budget horror film, immediately looks around for people who had done one. And so I started getting phone calls for those. And the quality of the film went up, you might say, to from films that were being done for $60,000 and $100,000 to, you know, films with an astronomical budget of $300,000 to $400,000.
Mm-hmm.
That was astronomical to me. So we were able to do things a little better. Well, as soon as you can deliver a little better quality film, it also gets noticed, and you get
another step up and another
step
up.
And then in at this point, after coming out of film school and having worked a little bit, I thought, well, maybe, you know, I think I'll go into this film thing, you know, cinematography thing seriously. So I had gone to the union and knocked on the little glass window.
Yes.
And the lady in there, pointed to the sign and walked away. And the sign said, "We are not a hiring hall. We're not accepting members." Well, I was not accepted into the union. It wasn't until the 80s, 81, when we did Escape from New York, that that became possible. The film, we all were hired on the film. We started the film, at least in pre-production. And then, it was because it was Avco Embassy, or a fairly major releasing person, they said, well, we're going to have to do this as a union film, which was certainly fine with all of us. because that became the opportunity to join. Prior to that, every year I would go and try to join and was denied membership.
Oh, well, that happened to a lot.
It certainly did. But by now going into a union film, yeah. It now opened another, door.
Let's talk about that. It was an organizing effort, or just AFCO went along with the period? And
no, actually it was very easy. It didn't have to be organized, and there was no, difficulties about it. It was a case of AFCO saying, no, I think we need to, this needs to be union film because all of our other
distribution.
Are, so they were, certainly happy with it. It was budgeted low enough that it didn't, it wasn't a
always
like
Escape
thing.
From New York. It was my vision of New York City. It's kind of like Blade Runner.
That was something too that was significant in that it was a film that I was able to give a real look to, and John Carpenter was very much attuned to.
Well, your association with him continuing on then from Halloween.
I'd done The Fog with him prior to that. He was very much aware of visuals, the importance of that, which is really good to have not only support but from a director, but encouragement to to do something.
Very dark movie, very black night. Never was daytime there.
Yeah, and it was a case of being able to give a look and a visual style to something that normally could have just been a very, very kind of pedestrian from that standpoint.
Was that done in Los Angeles? Or
part of it was in L.A. We went back to St. Louis to shoot the exteriors of New York because New York, it was impossible to shut off streets and stuff. And we found about a 3 or 4 block area of St. Louis that was destined for being reorganized.
Urbanized, yeah.
So there were just blocks of brick buildings and warehouses and things that we would have the free run of.
You could trash even more.
Oh yeah. So we would go out each night and that was part of one of the things that I had developed was as much pre-rigging of lighting and so forth as possible to give the company as much shooting time. And we had a rigging crew that would go out during the day, and I had drawn drawings of the alleys and the areas we were going to be shooting. I would rough in the lighting on the map, give that to them. They would take the diagram and set up the lighting. The dressing crew would show up with literally 3 pickup trucks full of trash and old refrigerators and stuff they just acquired from the junkyard. And they would go down and they'd shovel this stuff out into the alleys as the truck would drive down. And by the time we got there at night, all the trash would be in place and the lights would be set up on the fire escapes and all that stuff. And it gave us an opportunity to actually do the lighting rather than
focusing a little bit and go.
So that was one of the reasons that I think we were able to finish on schedule, on budget.
So this has this become sort of your technique to approach? Pre-rigging, a lot of pre-production?
It was a valuable lesson for me in the fact that it would help us finish on time, accommodate the needs of the producer and the production company and the director, but also give me enough time to fool around and acquire a look rather than working the first part of the night or day or whatever it is, unloading equipment and trying to figure out where to put it. So that's something I've always sort of carried through. I to this day will take the set drawings and walk around and try to visualize the lighting as much as possible, and do sketches of where the significant units should go, and then depending on how much time they've allotted for rigging crews and budget and so forth, have a rigging crew come in either early, like the day before. Sometimes we will take an earlier call for the electricians and add a couple of guys on a minimum call. They will set up the equipment so that by the time we're there, a lot of it is in place, and we can concentrate then on the aesthetic part of it
mm-hmm.
rather than the logistics.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's something that even today I do as much as possible in order to give the company and the director as much time to work during an allotted daytime than taking time up with people waiting while
well, Dean, your films have got such a distinctive look in terms of the dramatic and dark and moody and that kind of stuff, and that a lot of American cinematographers aren't allowed to act as artists as much as artisans, and you early on established that this is the way I want to do it, and you're able to make that stick, which is a great compliment.
I think that's something I sort of appreciate also, is the fact that I think what happens is you just as actors get typed, obviously in a particular character or whatever, because they do that character well, as a cameraman or as a production designer or any creative area, you can also get typed based on what you might have done in the past that was successful. One of the reasons I went into film, and one of the things I enjoy most about film and cinematography is the creation of illusion.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid, I was fascinated by magic, illusionists, and so forth. And I think that's what we are, the term magician of the movies is almost a cliche. I think that's what we're doing. We're always creating some kind of illusion, whether it's, the extreme fantasies that happen in effects films, or whether it's just the illusion that you're watching two actors in a courtroom, during a trial.
Mm-hmm.
There's
much illusion there, certainly.
Yeah, obviously they're not really in a courtroom. Those are actors pretending to be courtroom people. Well, I enjoy that, the illusion part of it, and what I can do in effects film is the most illusionary part of it, the most magical. So I think that's one of the things, but by having been involved with high illusion, you might say, from Halloween, Escape from New York,
all
of those things.
All of these,
it gives you the opportunity to, continue in that area, because as you get typed, as it were, or at least as long as you get recognized for that
mm-hmm.
best work, you've already now offered more opportunities to do that.
Well, and certainly we've gone through the last 20 years, movies are getting more and more exotic in terms of these illusions and because of these effects. But so many of your movies, Little China had a lot of effects.
Mm-hmm.
Roger Rabbit, of course, was a major cartoon effect. Hook was
mm-hmm.
a major cartoon effect. Do you find, and as you're moving through these things, of course, the technology is changing all the time and getting more and more exotic and getting more and more precise, for what you need to do. Do you find your approach changing as the time goes on?
I don't know if I'd say it's changing. I know it's expanding.
Mm-hmm.
I think that every film I do, every film, almost anybody does, draws on the experience of the last one.
Mm-hmm.
And what I enjoy doing is drawing on that experience and then taking it a step further,
mm-hmm.
and being offered the opportunity to do that by virtue of the next director, the next script, whatever it is, and being able to learn from the previous one and then apply that knowledge or technique and then say, well, we did that, but what would be really interesting? Why don't we now take it and do this? And having a director or a producer or somebody say, "Hey, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's do that." So, it's a case of being able to consistently do something interesting and further the technology, always kind of being on the leading edge of where that kind of thing is being done.
Well, also it's integrating all the effects too when you. Back to the Future series is one of those ones where you past and present and and some the artistic stuff involves a lot of things. It's not just a cartoon effect. And then you get into again the Roger Rabbit, which was a breakthrough movie in a lot of ways to reinsert a cartoon character. These are great movies. These are mm-hmm. these are a lot of fun to talk about. Do you extensively, obviously, involve yourself in the pre-production of these to the point where you're on the movie like several months ahead of time to make the design work, make the system work for you?
Yeah, it varies from show to show, but a lot of times my official or formal prep, I like to do non-consecutive prep, so mm-hmm. I will have, for instance, maybe out of 6 weeks of obligation, 2 weeks will be consecutive and continuous and start literally 2 weeks before principal, but 4 weeks will be spread out maybe over 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
What that does, it allows me to really absorb for a while, and I find that that's how I work. I don't really read a script and conceive of some way that's going to be done or the look that I want. A lot of times I will read it through a couple of times and not really do a lot of thinking. I'll kind of react maybe to the story and think about it a little bit. But what I like to do is then go and talk to the director and talk to the production designer and look at locations and kind of determine where how they see it and,
mm-hmm.
and the direction they want to go and absorb for a while, because I see my function as somebody who implements the vision of the director, and sometimes if they don't have a vision, help them find it.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to find out where all these people would like to go with their particular end of it, and then see how I can do the same thing in my area and embellish that. So I like to be involved as much as possible early on to do the absorbing. On Jurassic Park, there was kind of a luxury in that I had worked with Rick Carter, the production designer, on the Back to the Futures. And as soon as he finished Back to the Future 3, he began preparing Jurassic Park. At that point, I went to work on Hook
mm-hmm.
with Steven. And
oh, someone's at your door, isn't it?
Oh.
You tried to get that? How many?
Yes. They want to go. They want to go to the office. Yeah. As a matter of fact, here's Chris to help him.
Oh, okay.
On Jurassic Park, I was able to become involved because when I began Hook, Rick was designing Jurassic Park, and he would come over to the Hook set and bring drawings for Steven to look at, and I would look at them and evaluate and see what they were doing. At that time, I had no idea that I would be doing Jurassic Park.
Mm-hmm.
I was an interested observer.
Mm-hmm.
So I began to see the direction that Steven was thinking about on it, and the sets as they developed and the production design and so forth. I began to absorb
mm-hmm.
all throughout Hook what Jurassic Park was all about. So then at the end of Hook, Steven asked me to do Jurassic Park, which was going to start 5 or 6 months after that. And I said, great. So I then continued visiting the studio on Hook to work on the effects thing. And I would continue seeing Jurassic Park develop. And so I was able to absorb a lot of that stuff very early on.
Now, that one being a luxury, say, coming in that early, were you able to, shape it to the direction of, say, the look by saying, well, this thing might work better than that? And did they respect you as the director of photography? The stories I hear is a lot of guys come into a movie and they come in late and it's already designed, and they may be designed into a corner. The art director has locked him into a certain look that is difficult, the wrong angles for the star, that type of thing. And but by you coming in so early, you were able to shape it.
Yeah, actually, from a couple of layers, having worked with Rick Carter on the Back to the Future 2 and 3,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We had, you know, a common language and understanding.
Oh, sure.
And so forth. And he would actually come to me during his designing of Jurassic Park and say, you know, and ask for advice. He'd say, you know, if I wanted to put a backing on the stage but also have the sky, what would you want to see if you had to light that?
So mm-hmm.
You know, which is, you know, very encouraging to know that production designers
working with you. Yeah.
And this was before either of us knew that I would even be involved with the show during the hook thing. And it was a case of, you know, just two colleagues sort of advising each other on, you know, their viewpoints of things. And then as it, you know, throughout Hook, you know, Steven would ask me a question about it, or Rick would come and say, you know, if the set were like this, but we wanted a lot of depth, should we paint the trees grayed down green so we get the area on? Oh, yeah, that would be a real interesting idea. You know, and so it was a case of, you know, my really just, you know, offering opinions and advice. And, well, that paid off because by the time I then got into, you know, was offered Jurassic Park, and some direction had been taken, you know, that, you know, even unbeknownst to me, I had been, you know, providing.
Mm-hmm.
So that when it came down to building and design and so forth, you know, things had sort of started in the right direction without having to do a big turnaround.
Makes it a lot easier when you get on the set.
Absolutely.
And
so it was a case of, you know, of a great luxury of being involved in a production long before,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
I would have normally been involved.
Well, I keep seeing the same people popping up in your movies, the Spielberg, Steven Spielberg, of course, and you know, Joel Silver, and I'm just so impressed with the. let me just read this resume just for a second. And Dean, you're fairly modest gentlemen, but this, for the record here, Jurassic Park, at this point hasn't come out. It was about another 3 or 4 months before it's due.
Yeah, June 11th.
Okay.
93.
Death Becomes Her, a marvelous effects movie using all the latest high technology.
Yes, the boys won the Academy Award for the effects on that one this year.
Mm-hmm. And certainly you had something to do with making the effects work.
Well, I would hope that I was able to contribute to that.
Mm-hmm. Hook, which for the kids that recreated the Peter Pan again, that worked real good with Robin Williams. Nothing But Trouble, which... Well, I was on that set a couple
mm-hmm.
times. That movie was financially, shall we say, not so successful.
Mm-hmm.
Had one of the more impressive sets with the bone cruncher and the...
That was a case of a film that you learn on.
Uh-huh.
It was a... I hate to call it very expensive projector fodder. it was, in fact, you know, a film that, while not successful at the box office... a lot of people got to do some very interesting things on it.
Yeah, Dan may have overextended himself being the producer-director, Dan Aykroyd being producer-director, star,
mm-hmm.
and all those, the body things he had to put on, which has to take forever to work with.
Yes, right.
Really a tough one. But the Back to the Future, 1, 2, and 3. Roadhouse, that's about the straightest movie in this crowd so far. In terms
yeah,
of being
actually, it was kind of an interesting, you know, little diversion for me. You know, every now and then I like to do something that is just a straight film, you know, because
mm-hmm.
it, you know, it kind of allows me to maybe look at a little different direction, you know, and solve, you know, some different kinds of problems.
More of a straight-ahead acting
right.
Thing and something that where you're developing characters more
mm-hmm.
on an acting level rather than an effects level.
Right.
Big Business, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Roger Rabbit, One of the all-time classics. What a sweet movie to be making and have. They're going to do more of those kinds of movies? Or is this,
Well, I know Disney has been hoping for a while to do a sequel to that.
They've been pumping out
Roger Rabbit
cartoons too. With it. But
it certainly was was very influential in a lot of areas. I mean, it sort of revived an interest in animation in the case of an audience, I think.
And animation mixed with live action, which
right,
is the
and
big twist.
Definitely revived an interest in that. I mean, commercials immediately picked up on that, and there was a whole resurgence of commercials that combined animation with live action, but in a much more effective way than had been done in the past. You know, Roger has left his mark.
Definitely, and as well he should. I mean, this revived things, but it took it several steps further on. The Toons world had a lot in it for everybody. It wasn't just a kiddie show, and it wasn't an adult show.
No, and it's actually one of the shows I'm most proud of, you might say, as far as the kinds of things we did and the influence that has been felt by it, but also the fact that it was one of the most challenging kinds of films to do, because even though animation live action had been done in the past, we were able to take it in areas that had never been done before. You know, Disney early on had said, well, you know, we've done a lot of these films. I mean, you know, we did Mary Poppins, we did Pete's Dragon. You know, here's how you do it. You lock the camera down, you know, and you have the actors move around in there, and then we put the animation over that, and that's how you do it. And we said, well, but it always looks like that. you know, that in reality, if these characters existed, we would pan them around and follow and do boom shots and stuff.
Yeah,
I mean, that's how you. They said, oh, no, that's way too hard. Yeah, I don't think that can be done. And we said, that's exactly what we wanted to hear. You know, as soon as you tell us it can't be done, that's when we want to do it.
That's when the juices start flowing,
right.
Yeah.
So we, we were fortunate that finding a lot of people at the right place at the right time, you might say. Richard Williams, the animator, was immediately challenged by the fact that Disney had said, no, you lock the camera down. He said, no, I've been doing moving perspective with characters for years. It can be done. We just have to find out how to do it. So, you know, it opened up a whole kind of area of challenge for us and intrigue. And what we did then was we shot a test, and when we discovered it could in fact be done, you could move the camera and the characters and everything all at once. It then freed up all of our thought processes, and the process of thinking was always, well, if the character really did exist, what would he do and where would the camera be? And we were never limited by how to do it and whether we should or shouldn't move the camera. And we began looking at all these tricks that we could do to create the illusion that the characters existed in the same time and space.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think that's one of the things that about Roger Rabbit that was most rewarding, was the ability to do something that, first of all, you know, we'd been told, you know, it's almost impossible, it can't be done, and then pull it off to the extent that everybody else started doing that.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's still leaving room in the frame for the animation, and it's I'm just making a couple of assumptions. I'd like to hear you talk about it, because you were there and I wasn't. But it's still leaving someone in the frame space in the frame for the animation to go in, you had Roger was already designed, so you knew how big he was supposed to be relative to everybody else. Did you use a stand-in, a card, or a...
Yeah, we had... There was a couple of techniques we used and some thought process that we had to go through. First of all, we built life-size rubber poseable models of Roger and the Weasels and a lot of the main characters. Unfortunately, there was never a full life-size poseable model of Jessica.
Mm-hmm. She was great.
But they everybody kept asking for one.
To take home with.
Yeah. But I would walk this rubber character through the shot, or Bob Zemeckis would walk the character through the shot while the character voice was being read off camera. And the actors would relate to it. Bob Hoskins would look at the character to understand where the where his eye line would have to be, where the character would be. And it would also give us a chance to block the action as if it were really a character. And then it also gave the opportunity for the operator to understand what the shot was about, because it's interesting that as an operator you're used to reacting to what you see in the frame.
Mm-hmm.
Composition is kind of set by what's there.
Mm-hmm.
And when an actor moves, you know, you will adjust the composition. And when there's nothing in the frame and nothing moves, you know, you don't adjust. You know, you'll tend to compose for what looks, how the set looks good, or for the actors that are there.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a case of Ray Stella learning new reflexes, because he had to be able to imagine, you know, something that wasn't there. So when we would work with the rubber rabbit,
mm-hmm.
he had the visual cues of how to, you know, to compose. And when the rabbit would jump on the chair, he would adjust for the
mm-hmm.
composition
mm-hmm.
of that.
Mm-hmm.
And it became a case of him then learning from the dialogue, learning from
where the cues were for all the other
actors were, and having to imagine the rabbit there and being able to move the camera when nothing else in the frame moved. Being able to pan the camera across and get to the exact composition of nothing there that looked odd on the monitor because it was an empty set, and it looked jarring because, you know, the chair was only partly in frame and the window was cut off at the wrong spot. It wasn't
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
aesthetically pleasing for that purpose. But when you put the rubber rabbit in there, you say, oh, yes,
fits.
Of course, it fits. And then we take the rubber rabbit out, you know, there was, you know, the composition that was needed. So he had to learn to memorize all of this real unusual kind of operating that didn't make sense visually, you know, according to his reflexes.
The invisible man on first, when we used to play baseball and there
mm-hmm.
wasn't enough guys around.
Right.
The invisible player has to, oh, he's going over here and
right.
he's going over there.
Exactly.
That's a whole new skill to develop.
Yeah, and it was one that, you know, he developed, you know, very well. And so the process, the thought process was, if the rabbit really existed, and he did with this rubber one, where would he go? And we would act that out. And how would the camera move? And that was what we would work out then with dolly moves and so forth. And then Ray would learn those moves. Then we take, and the actors would learn it. We'd take out the rubber rabbit and we would shoot it, and we ended up with a moving background that and we would then shoot a reference shot. We'd shoot
mm-hmm.
it once with a rubber rabbit in, so that later the animators would understand the intention
on film.
You didn't
do this on tape or the videotape.
No,
you did that on film.
We would actually shoot on film. There would be a film record of where we wanted the rabbit to appear in frame,
mm-hmm.
and when he was supposed to move. So then, as it was edited together, the editor would refer to these reference shots to understand what the shot was all about, but to put together the empty plates. Then they would do a turnover meeting where Bob would sit with all the animators and the layout people and the key people and run the background plate, but he'd also run the reference shot and say, okay, now see this camera move where the camera tilts up,
mm-hmm.
And there's nothing in frame? Well, that's when the rabbit jumps on the chair.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they did, oh, okay, the rabbit jumps on the chair. there would be frame counts and all of this technical stuff
right.
that they would convert to their bar charts, so that, in fact, we didn't then have arbitrary camera moves while the animators actually had the rabbit move through the
yes.
frame otherwise.
They were instructing him
right.
where they wanted to, like
and
another actor.
Exactly. And they had to, it was interesting because the animators at first were resistant. They were used to conceiving a shot, animating the character, and that's the way it would be. And suddenly there would begin restrictions. They had to make the character move when the background moved instead of animating and then having the background move to accommodate what they did. So they found that they were being forced into particular things. Well, at first they said, oh, well, wait a second, usually I'm the one who decides that.
Mm-hmm.
But after a while, a lot of them started to actually liked the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
They had to find a logical reason to, you know, or some interesting bit of action
mm-hmm.
to get the rabbit up to the chair. There were even times when, which was one of the great delights to me, was, you know, there would be like some kind of a camera move that we had envisioned, you know, the rabbit to do something else. And the animators would find even a better reason
for
the move. They would move one of the background characters and then the rabbit or whatever.
Uh-huh.
Well, it was those little things that created the illusion that we were actually watching this live action, because the camera was moving to follow animated characters. And so the animators started really kind of accepting the challenge of trying to get their acting, the rabbits
mm-hmm.
that they were doing.
Well, it's human acting rather than
right.
cartoon acting.
Right. Into the frame that was being sort of dictated
it.
To them. I think it worked out well. I mean, there are some actually really brilliant moments that they did to accommodate various things. Props that move. Well, sometimes we would just put a little, we'd say, you know, if this was in the way of the rabbit, he'd move it aside. So we'd put monofilament on and move an object.
They integrated even
right?
more.
And the animator, we'd say, look, see that thing move? You have to do something there. And so they would do something where the rabbit would gesture and hit it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, immediately you believe that the rabbit is
sure.
there. So it's those kinds of things that we started doing as our thinking process.
Well, and not only that too, but the animation really interacted with the actors. I mean, he just didn't stand there
mm-hmm.
next to him. He pulled his tie. He beat him up. They fought.
Yeah.
You know, it became a crossover that
mm-hmm.
was far in advance than previous efforts like that had ever gone. Was that tough to do? Was it?
What was interesting was that it was a challenge to start with, because you're not used to thinking in those terms. You know,
mm-hmm.
again, you're used to reacting to what's in the frame, what actors do, and
mm-hmm.
when there is no actor, you know, you as a cameraman, as a director, whatever, aren't used to doing it for them. Well, it got to the point where we were finding ways to, you know, do the acting for the rabbit,
mm-hmm.
Move the props.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would say, you know, it'd be interesting. How about if we move this chair in the middle of the room, and when the rabbit comes through, he has to push it aside. Oh, good idea. You know, and you really sort of got involved
yeah.
in the rabbit's performance.
Made him into a better actor.
Oh, yeah.
Well, then you went, just to stay with Roger Rabbit for a second, then you went to Toontown. And that became Bob Hoskins on chroma key. Is it a blue screen type of event at that
yeah,
point?
Yeah, it was blue screen. We were then doing the opposite of what the rest
right,
of the picture
exactly.
did, which was putting cartoon characters in real life. We then had to take a real character and put him in an entirely animated world, backgrounds
mm-hmm.
and everything. So Bob was working constantly on an entire blue screen set
mm-hmm.
with a blue screen floor. We had Miraplex reflecting the thing, so that he existed only in this absolute void of blue. And we then developed a system where we would take the video tap off of the camera and put it on a screen, and then we had another setup with a camera on a looking down in an animation pegboard. And we had Bill Frake, the layout artist, sitting there, and we'd say, okay, now what will this background look like? And he'd very quickly sketch a city
mm-hmm.
street or
mm-hmm.
a building or something. And we'd position Bob in the frame.
Oh, wild.
Next to what is going to be the door or the lamppost, whatever.
On the video screen.
On the video screen, right. And he would be automated into the
mm-hmm.
net. Layout drawing,
mm-hmm.
And we'd say, well, you know what? Let's make the lamppost a little so they make the lamppost bigger, you know,
mm-hmm.
or they'd move
mm-hmm.
it closer to the foreground. And I'd look at that and say, okay, now the source of light's coming from the lamppost.
Oh, you'd light for that,
right?
Yeah.
So now I would put, you know, very warm light from that direction, you know, and fill on the other side and backlight from the one down the street, you know. we'd look for neon signs that were blinking. We'd say, well, let's put a neon sign on this building. And Bill would draw in this neon sign. We'd say, okay, it's red and it's blinking. So we then we would, you know, put in
a What a lot of freedom to do that. Isn't
that
terrific?
So we'd shoot that plate, and it would come back with this blinking red glow on one side of Bob and a warm key light on the other.
So they'd use it as a design plate then to start with. They'd touch it up, but it would be
and then Bill would take this drawing and say, okay, that's basically it. Then he would go back and he would draw the layout of that, which would then went to the background artist, with the notes that it had to have a red neon sign. And then when they would shoot that, they would animate in the red glow that was blinking on and off, and they would have to match it to where it was blinking on the actor. So that became a process of, again, creating the interaction, the tie-in between the live-action character in the cartoon background.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Great. Is it a slow process?
It was at first.
Uh-huh.
Because you're redoing your reflexes and your instincts about something. You are teaching yourself a new procedure. But I think as we began thinking in those terms and realized that either they're going to work or we'd find some way to make them work, you begin to sort of automatically think in those terms, and you begin very quickly to create situations and techniques and moments and
so you can move pretty good after you got it going.
After that, it became a case of really having a way to quickly, expand a scene or get it to work within the context of what
so,
we're
so
doing.
You on the set were designing Toontown and with a committee, with the director and with the artist, and you were saying what it would be neat if we had this and that, and so that was part of the process and was really designing
it
at the time.
It was really obviously, film, as I said, is a very collaborative art, craft, and it was a case of all these people being focused on that.
I mean, you're still following a script, and you're still following a direction of what's going to happen, but the specifics of it, you're moving along. Oh, that's great. That's great. Your credits are so incredible. Please, I can say these things. It goes. We just stopped at Roger Rabbit, but there's Romancing the Stone. That's a straight adventure. Very little effects per se, but a lot of mud, a lot of rain, a lot of stuff to do to make that work. Was that a good shoot?
Yeah, actually, it was the first film I'd worked with Bob Zemeckis on. And it was probably logistically the most difficult one I had done up to that point. Even now, we were working in Mexico with heavy rains and mudslides, and shooting in areas that were normally kind of inaccessible.
Mm-hmm.
We would have to take trucks down very dirt, narrow dirt roads.
So this is a caravan type show, to move it in and move it out.
Right. I really, for all of the hardship, enjoyed that very much because it was, my collaborative effort with Bob was great. The backgrounds, the scenery, the places we were shooting were really very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It was constantly challenging from the standpoint of overcoming the weather and how do you match stuff from day to day and creating all the mood and ambience and everything that went into it. So I enjoyed that, and the fact that it was a successful film is also nice. I mean, that's one of the things you always dread is the fact that you or a lot of people are going to spend a lot of time and effort and money on a film.
Mm-hmm.
And come up with something that nobody goes to see.
Mm-hmm. Kathleen Turner and Michael Douglas, and putting those two together and making those characters, the friction with that happening, the sparks flying and the romance. Oh, great stuff.
Yes, yeah, it was.
Yeah, so you had a lot of fun parts in that. Big Trouble in Little China, which I liked. I don't think that was as successful as people would have preferred to see, but I thought it was a lot of fun. You know, it
was. I enjoyed that one also. Mm-hmm. Again, it's a case of a film where a lot of people dedicated a lot of effort and energy and creative energy into a film that unfortunately a lot of people didn't go see.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably a film that will have some longevity.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not necessarily topical. It's something that's just kind of a fun, entertaining romp.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
You know, the video cassette has certainly prolonged the life of a film.
That's right, something cassette, yeah.
So, and it was a lot of fun because it was, again, creating a lot of visual style. And the art director, John Lloyd, was, you know, really excellent, the production designer. You know, it was just visually one of those things that was challenging and
mm-hmm.
a lot of fun.
Well, and your filmography goes on. Psycho 2, an attempt at going back to the Hitchcockian. I think I recall the director was really, really trying to
That to me was a fascinating film, not so much from the standpoint of the film itself,
mm-hmm.
But it kind of was, for me, a window into Hitchcock in the past. The producer was Hilton Green, who had been the assistant director on the original Psycho. And as we recreated the film, we went back and viewed the original many times. We looked at they found as much of the original art pieces, and they recreated the sets exactly of the interior of the house. They weren't able to find the drawings, the original drawings, because when Hitchcock made Psycho, he was just making a quick
knockoff
film. You know, he had been they'd said, "Well, can you do a film quickly? Because you'd just done a big budget one, North by Northwest or something or other."
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "You know, I tell you what, I'm going to take my TV crew, and we're just going to go off and do this quick little movie." Which obviously has become a classic of the time. Well, to go over that film shot by shot, to hear the stories from Hilton Green about the making of the original Psycho, he would have these really interesting little insights. For instance, he said, "Well, watch this scene here. Now, see, Martin Balsam, the cop, when he shows up at the motel."
Mm-hmm.
"Why does he slide across the front seat of the car and get out the passenger side? Why doesn't he just get out of the car and walk around?" We said, "Well, I guess, I don't know, maybe Hitchcock wanted to save time. He didn't want the time of pulling back to reveal as he gets out or anything." He said, "No. The car was up against the inside stage wall. We couldn't get the door open." So Hitch said, "Well, you know what? Just get out the passenger side, because we can't take time to move the car."
A little practicality here.
And so he slid across the seat and got out the passenger side out of necessity. You know, and to me, that's always one of the amusing things, is to read critics, right, who will review and analyze and take apart a film and find all this intense meaning. You know, and having worked on a film, a lot of times you realize that what you did was just out of necessity, or was entirely an accident.
Yeah,
you know, I mean. No, the cop did not slide across the seat because he wanted, the relationship between the officialness of driving the car and that of the passenger, who was normally just someone who came along. There was no psychological, we couldn't get the door open, you know, there's the only
And there you
door.
Go, yeah.
So, you know, it was fascinating to have Hilton go through the original Psycho and give us a lot of these kind of insights about the way it was with Hitchcock, the time he showed up on the set, and he had just come from somewhere and didn't have it on his coat and tie.
Mm-hmm.
And Hitch went over to him and said, "Hilton, we're a little underdressed, aren't we?" And walked away. And Hilton went to wardrobe and borrowed a tie and a coat, because Hitchcock required the assistant director and a lot of his key people to always wear a coat and tie.
Oh, yeah, it's a very formal guy. Yeah.
So that was one of the fascinating things about Psycho 2, and working with Tony Perkins, who would talk about his part of the character. And
he became the strangest actor for many years after that.
And yeah.
His career continued on in that kind of a very dark vein.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He worked on The Thing, which, getting sick and tired of Carol's syrup. I mean, it's pouring all that stuff all over the...
Yeah, well, it's something you learn to live with, I think.
It is Carol's syrup, isn't it? Isn't
rubber
it?
And Carol's syrup.
Yeah, rubber and Carol's syrup, yeah.
KY jelly and KY, all
yeah.
the things.
Make that, the greasy gooey.
Right, all of the things that are part of doing creatures.
That go bumping tonight. But that one, it was a remake, of course, but you managed to get the tension in it again, get a another critter that attacked the good guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was, again, an interesting learning experience for me from the standpoint that it was some of the early cable-controlled creature puppets and
mm-hmm.
things that Rob Bottin was, you know, part of developing a lot of those techniques, and it was, again, a very visual film, John Carpenter being, you know, visually oriented. So it was a fun kind of thing for me to be, you know, involved with, you know, creating the illusion again of creatures that were rubber.
But this one was more of a puppet and affair rather than like Jurassic Park is now, where it's animation and you know, post production.
Right.
Kind of, so this is more of a physical effects.
Yeah, Jurassic Park. About half of the dinosaurs that you'll see or have already seen, in the case of when this is past the release date, half of them are puppets and rubber creatures that, in fact, draw on the techniques that, you know, were started and developed with The Thing and by Rob Bottin and
mm-hmm.
Rick
mm-hmm.
Baker and all the guys that
integrating
right.
both the puppet and the and the special effects. You've been very generous about sharing with us some of the techniques, but let's get to what is going on with the present and say the future with Jurassic Park. You're on the cutting edge of all the new technologies and the new styles that may be coming out. The new techniques are starting to become available. What do you see? What first off, how was Jurassic Park made in terms of? I don't think we're telling any secrets that aren't going to be in every
no. It's,
you know, cinematography book or anything.
You know, and this is the kind of thing that's important to document, because what I will now describe is absolutely the cutting edge. And if you're watching this 20 years from now, you know, you're probably going to laugh at me and say, why did he even dream of that? But what's fascinating to me about the techniques of Jurassic Park and, you know, some of the other things that I've been doing is the fact that what's happening is the blending of electronic, digital
compositing,
you know, compositing video, all of the things that have, you know, been developing.
The Cineon method is, I think,
Cineon,
the Kodak
is working on,
mm-hmm.
And the all of the stuff that ILM is doing with their computers,
mm-hmm.
and all of those are, you know, as of today, techniques that are coming, essentially, you might say, from a video end of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the things that we take for granted with moving, you know, type and things on the news is really just the very beginning of the things that are now being very, you know, sophisticatedly developed for film.
Mm-hmm.
And we are now going to start using it more and more in film. And it's opening up some amazing, tremendously interesting creative areas for cinematographers. You know, again, it's something that it's important for us to not only read about or learn, but embrace, to go to and learn, you know, very aggressively, because they are tools that are going to be, you know, important.
Required to use
In a while. And they're not, you know, there's nothing to be feared or intimidated by, you know, they're how to operate a light or a new type of camera. You know, they're things that are going to make our jobs more creative, more interesting, easier, you know, more challenging in some ways. And the techniques are incredible. The fact that they are able to now take a wireframe dinosaur, generate on it a skin that is real looking, alter the lighting on it to match exactly whatever lighting, you know, I put into the set, and get you and composite that in and get you to believe that it exists in
all
the
same
time
computer.
And space from the computer.
Yeah, all on the computer.
To the same extent that we were able to kind of do that with Roger, is just part of what is possible with the digital. I mean, you know, everybody says, oh, we'll be able to create actors, we'll be able to do all that stuff. Well, that's part of it. But it's also a tool that we'll be using. What I'm finding is that on Back to the Future, for instance, we were doing on 2 and 3, we were compositing actors into with blue screen so they could talk to themselves. We were doing moving splits so that they could walk around the frame and two people could be in the frame at the same time.
Well, they were talking to themselves in the future and the present.
Exactly.
Whichever senses they were, there were two people at the same time.
Well, part of that was the ability for me to put a light in the shot to create a particular lighting effect, knowing that that part was going to be split out later. And then I could put a light in this half of the frame, knowing that that frame part was going to be split out in another part.
The garbage map.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that I was able to actually do kind of lighting things that wouldn't have been possible because the lights would have appeared in the frame.
Mm-hmm.
They are
mm-hmm.
actually able to optically remove the lights.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was done with a fairly straightforward film technique with the optical printer, the thing that is going to become obsolete. Because the computer is going to take over the work of the optical printer. And it's going to allow us to put lights in the frame, to build sets with no ceilings, and put lights up there, and we can photograph the set without the ceiling, knowing that they are going to take the drawing of the set and just input that in as a draftsman would with a CAD program, and take you know, paint colors or textures or whatever, input that in, and the computer is going to put a ceiling onto a set
that matches totally.
Right. What the technique that would be done as a matte painting will be done essentially in the computer, and as the technique becomes easier, as it becomes cheaper and faster, that's the kind of thing that we will just you know, you won't have to hire an artist to paint a painting. You'll be able to take an existing drawing of the set and put that in very quickly, an existing color, or you just turn a knob and say, well, it looks a little more green paint on the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll tweak it and be able to, you know, create, you know, paintings, matte paintings and optical effects with a much less effort than before. The trick is, at this point, is getting it cheap enough that and fast enough that the film will go through a computer and come out again quickly. And also educating all of ourselves, the production designer, the producer, the director, anybody involved in it, on the creative potential for it and so forth. Matte paintings will be able to be done out of existing footage. They'll just take stock footage that's shot and high quality photographs, 8x10 transparencies or whatever.
Sampling.
Sample, you know, trees and skies and mountains and stuff and concoct, you know, images and paintings and so forth. And with difference matting, we won't have to worry as much about a giant blue screen. You know, you'll be able to shoot an actor against a plain wall anywhere and put him in. So the techniques will make those kinds of things easier and easier. We'll be able to look at a shot and say, oh, you know, it's a shame we had a bald sky that day. Look how, wouldn't this desert shot have been beautiful if, well, they'll be able to say, well, let's take out the sky and put in a nice blue sky.
Which sky do you want?
Yeah. You know, oh, wait, no, call up the sunset one. That looked really good. Yeah, that's the one.
There we go.
And, you know, so it's an amazing tool that's going to open up the creative possibilities for a lot of people, and particularly ourselves. You know, we'll be able to get rid of things that bothered us. The wall was too hot, darn, I should have put a double in that light.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's just tone down that wall back there a little bit. You'll, you know, highlight an area and turn down the knob.
Mm. And it what it looks like, and it doesn't look like anything much, it just... couple of computer heads right there, and
mm-hmm.
large monitors, and
right.
and the input from
mm-hmm.
wherever source you're having.
Right, and you know, we look at it now as needing big computer power and input and output devices and stuff. But you know, you look at the video editing systems that were so gigantic and cumbersome a few years ago are now becoming little desktop
mm-hmm.
things. You know, it's the same with I think the digital compositing is over a period of time, you know, it'll become, you know, a desktop kind of operation.
Sure.
That,
and the morphine that we're seeing now will be a commonplace event.
Mm-hmm.
It won't be any great shakes. You want to take a mole off someone's face, there it is. Or you
mm-hmm.
want to make their nose bigger or less or whatever.
Right.
You can do all that sculpting.
Mm-hmm. Right.
On the
yeah.
spot. Too much. It's going to get exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Let me do something right here. I'm going to pull back until we... Now, Dean doesn't normally put his awards up on the mantle, but we asked him to. Let's go over these just for a second, because I'm sure this is your problem. The first one I have is the British Academy Awards Certificate of Nomination for... I'm reading this. It doesn't... Oh, for Roger Rabbit. I see it down there. Yes. That's... That was pretty terrific. And then the next one?
Yes, the
nomination?
American Academy nomination.
Yes.
For Roger Rabbit.
Again for Roger Rabbit.
Yeah.
And next one over there is for Hook, for Outstanding Cinematography for Hook. This is from the ASC. As well, you
right.
deserve it.
Mm-hmm.
And then the ACE Award, which is a nice little Ace of Spades in silver,
mm-hmm.
right? And that was for Roger Rabbit again?
No, that was for the pilot episode of Tales of the Crypt.
Oh, okay.
Right. Cable show.
Well, I've seen it a number of times. Another gooey, wet thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
and over here, of course, we had to put up this poster of Roger Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which is what we've been talking about so much. It's been a lot of fun. Dean, I've really been enjoying talking to you, because you've been to so many places that you've taken me to so many places in your movies.
Oh, well,
you know, to begin with.
I think that's kind of what it's all about. The thing I enjoy is, you know, taking an audience somewhere they either haven't been or couldn't possibly go, and like I say, creating the illusion.
And quite a ride. Along about this time, usually we ask Howie Block to come on down and
mm-hmm.
tag team.
Howie
gets to ask a couple questions. He's been watching and listening, and hope you've been as informed as I. Howie, there you go.
Hi, Dean.
Hi, how are you?
I'm glad we're finally able to get together after a myriad of phone calls and schedule changing. Actually, this conversation has been going so well that most of the questions that I usually have have already been asked and answered. I have one burning question that's really driving me crazy. Do you ever hear from that damn rabbit? I mean, do you ever call? Do you ever come over? Do you ever
no.
care about you?
You know, that was the thing at the time, that when we were shooting it, he was never there, you know, when you needed him. And now I wait around for him to come by and, you know, visit or something, and he still hasn't shown up.
I know there was something about that rabbit that I didn't like, and that to me, he doesn't care. He doesn't never calls. He doesn't write. He doesn't send Christmas cards. It's terrible. And anyway, you touched on one of the things I'd like to ask about is some advice for youngsters who are coming into business. You started to talk about it. Can you just expand on that a little bit?
Well, I guess if if I use my own background and experience as a guide, I would say that you should look for every opportunity you can to learn, you know, actually almost anything, but specifically about film. Never turn down anything, no matter, you know, how unusual it seems. You know, I mean, I've worked with guys who say, oh, I don't know, I don't think I want to do that project, the hours will be too long, or the conditions, or whatever. You know, look for every opportunity to kind of expose yourself to it, even if you work for free on as a production assistant, or you know, just hang out on a set, or work on a small project, you know, just to get the experience. Because it isn't just the experience, you know, it's also, like I say, the networking, the finding people that, you know, can possibly offer you another opportunity later. You know, always doing more than they expect, you might say, you know, deliver more than you promised. That's something that, because I've worked with a lot of producers and you talk to them, and they, when they are asked, you know, I just recently was part of a little seminar where the people were asking the producer, now, what do you look for in a production assistant, and how does one become a producer, and so forth, and the same thing applies, I think, in camera or anything, is your enthusiasm for a job, always taking the job seriously, no matter how unusual a project, you know, approaching it as if it's the most important piece of work you've ever done. Because part of what will happen is you will get evaluated for your attitude and how much you're going to contribute to a project. And I think that because this is collaborative art, that the more people contribute, the more valuable they become. And so, looking for any way to demonstrate that you are interested in contributing to a project, enthusiasm, you know, offering to do, you know, a job that someone else turns down. Those, I think, are all important things. And again, I never took a class. I never worked on a film. I didn't ever do anything where I didn't learn something that gets used. I mean, in our business, we deal in so many crafts and techniques, everything from art and lighting to understanding explosions and mechanics and understanding psychology of working with a crew and you know, relating to actors and all kinds of things like that. So that's something that is important. Learning as much about everything as possible in all areas. In some way or the other, it's going to serve you. And, you know, I guess that's it in a nutshell, the secret of success.
Well, that's great advice. Just one more quick question. We're very rapidly running out of time and tape. In between assignments, what do you do to keep yourself busy? What are your interests outside of cinematography? Hobbies and so forth.
Well, it's interesting. I work. My wife is part of. She's the president of a nonprofit children's theater. I really enjoy working with her and the kids. In a you know, where I can offer some of my experience and expertise in that area. So I work. I enjoy working in musical theater. I work with our local high school and the summer theater with you know, set design and lighting and all the things that I can offer, and you know, that's something I enjoy. I mean, it's good, like returning, you know, my good fortune, and I don't know. I don't say I have a lot of hobbies. such. I mean, I'm not really an avid golfer. I play a little bit. I enjoy working with the computer and doing graphics. You know, again, I kind of gravitate to things that are, you know, visually creative and that kind of thing. I do posters and things for a lot of our local organizations and using the computer and the graphics and a lot of things, again, that I kind of learned in college. And I periodically go and either lecture or whatever at the film schools and, mm-hmm. and things like that.
Well, that's marvelous. In fact, I've about run out of questions. I'm going to pass the microphone back to Mr. Nefsey. We'll wrap this thing up. Thank you very much, Dean.
Thank you. You know, we've got a few more minutes. I got 15 minutes left on tape. And,
now you can tell.
Well, no, come on. You know, Howie, got anything more to say? No, Howie's going to bail out on us.
No.
we could wrap this up and have
a sulk.
You're going to go sulk?
Okay. I'm going to go sulk.
Where we could wrap this up and have a just a terrific hour, 45 minutes. You've been so generous sharing this information. I'd like to ask you a little bit more about technique and you've talked a lot about in the general terms how you approach things, but in the specifics, do you like using specific films, specific filters, specific lenses these days? Do you like Lumicrane? I heard Steven Spielberg was a pretty good Lumicrane operator.
Mm-hmm.
He likes
actually he is.
He likes to use it. Those kind of areas. Is there a specific lighting technique that you can describe? Or it's probably that what's appropriate for the scene. But
yeah, it really is. I think I'm kind of a pick and choose
mm-hmm.
sort of person, and I find that I am reactive. I react to the script and the director and the set and the actors and so forth. And I kind of like to adapt the tools that are at my disposal to fulfilling the need that's required. So as far as, film stocks, it's whatever is required by the particular shot or sequence or whatever as far as film speed and the grain and whether it's going to be done, whether the opticals are involved or whether it's straightforward or whether you're working at night or interior. I mean, this is kind of the typical thing I think that a lot of guys go through mm-hmm. when they make these choices. The same with lenses. I tend to try to keep things simple. I think my philosophy is to fulfill the requirements without being intrusive, without being obvious about a shot
mm-hmm.
or technique or something like that. You know, I think you don't want to draw so much attention to the shot that you're doing or the whole sequence or whatever that it suddenly draws the audience out of, you know, either the characters or the story point or whatever. So I kind of try to accommodate the requirements and to embellish the drama or embellish the scene without really being intrusive. And for that reason, I try to keep things as simple as possible. I don't use a lot of filtration,
mm-hmm.
Except now and then to maybe soften an image or a whole film.
So that your filtrations, if you were working, what's your favorite these days? Frost? Promist?
Yeah, I think more recently I've been using just a little bit of Promist.
So a quarter or eighth even?
Yeah,
a
quarter and or half.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's again, it depends on,
just take the edge off
shot.
It a little bit.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, I tend to not use filters.
Mm-hmm.
Just go very, crisp.
Mm-hmm. Panavision Primos?
Panavision Primos now being sort of the state of the art as of 1993.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that I tend to use. They're very sharp.
Almost too sharp, people claim.
Yeah, what's interesting is that I'm finding that if we shoot a whole sequence with the primos and then have to go to an unusual camera, mm-hmm. a snorkel camera or mm-hmm. something like that, where you've got a lot of lot more optics and things in the mm-hmm. way, mm-hmm. That the shot from that camera will suddenly stick out because you know, at this point it's impossible for that camera to be as sharp as the primos. So I'm finding that I have to degrade the primo image if I know that we have to use the snorkel camera or something, or some particular unusual situation, so that it suddenly doesn't look like an unusual
pop
shot.
Into it, yeah.
Right.
The comment has been made, not about your pictures, but that everyone uses Panavision, everyone uses Kodak, everyone uses the primo lenses, so the pictures all look kind of the same. And I'm just trying to figure out how you achieve your look. Do you expose an extra stop and then print down? That's common technique. Or push the film. It used to be that everyone, that was, you know, these things go through 10 trends, you know.
Right.
Flashing film was a big deal for several years, and now it's taking film that's 400 on the box and calling it 600 just
mm-hmm.
all the way through. Any particular styles that you've happy with?
No, I think I do tend to overexpose a little bit, so that the printing is done in the high 30s, low 40s,
mm-hmm.
you might say, on the printer scale, so that the blacks are nice. And so I tend to rate the film at anywhere from 500 to 600,
mm-hmm.
To kind of automatically do that. You know, I think that you know, as far as using Panavision or Kodak or whatever, that is you know, partly because, you know, it's a handy tool.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I tend to do that because it's American stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
know,
mm-hmm.
and just as part of keeping you know, our economy, you know, as much as possible. And if everybody does a little bit,
it's also pretty nice equipment.
Yes, and of course it is. It's you know, the you know, it's nice to know that the American technology, the equipment, is in fact, you know, some of the best, most sophisticated stuff, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And we like to reward that.
Mm-hmm. The Fuji film tends to look still a little bit odd for our taste, and
mm-hmm.
The Agfa tends to look a little warm for our taste,
mm-hmm.
and so it ends up being a, they certainly know their market out there, the Kodak
mm-hmm.
folks.
Right.
Motion control and camera control, do you find yourself going more towards the hothead type of a system?
I like the mobility, the flexibility of movement that you get with a remote head on a crane arm. So I found that I've been using a remote head a lot more frequently.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we typically will carry one throughout the whole show.
Matthew's camera mode, isn't that the
right
one you guys use?
Yeah, the camera mode. And that and the Crane 88, which is their arm that goes on dollies. And what it does is, because so much of contemporary storytelling in film requires, you know, moving cameras and putting cameras in unusual places, you know, it allows you to do that quickly and effectively. You know, when you learn to use a tool like that, it becomes a time saver, as opposed to, you know, a lot of times the production managers say, oh no, we're bringing out the big expensive thing. You know, you find that you can do three shots in the space of the time of one setup, just
mm-hmm.
because you can swing the arm over and use the remote head to reposition the camera, and you do some lighting, and then you turn and say, we're ready, and everybody says, oh my goodness.
Long before the actors are ready.
Yeah. So, you know, it's something that, as you learn to use it, and as you, you know, it's also, I think, one of the things that low budget filmmaking taught me was learning to look ahead.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't just look at this shot and then say, oh, I'll get to the next shot later. You know, you talk to the director and say, well, now where are we going with this whole scene?
Mm-hmm. The sequence, yeah.
And he'll say, well, how about this and this and this? And I say, well, you know, if instead of the actor walking there, if he walks over there, we're probably going to be lit for that already. Can we stage the scene so that, oh, yeah, okay. And if you have a director who understands that, then you have set yourself up so that now you have minimal relighting for your second shot, or maybe not at all. And if you can set your everything up as far as where your camera is and so forth, and use the crane or the dolly, you set up the dolly track so that not only is the dolly shot used for the entrance, but you say, you know what, why don't we, when we have him go out, we'll also use the dolly for the exit. You get a free dolly shot of that, and also then we'll just move it down here. We're ready for the close-up. Oh, yeah, that's a good idea. So learning to look ahead like that was...
anticipating.
Right. And also knowing that you're going to have to light a particular area for the next shot. You know, you can go to the gap and say, well, the next thing is we'll probably be looking over here because I can see that the reverse...
it's coming up.
...is coming up, you know, and we're going to see that. So then the guys start to get, you know... and that's something that is valuable, I mean, even... or even especially so in big budget shows, let alone
mm-hmm.
low budget
mm-hmm.
shows, and using a remote head and a crane arm, if you can say, well, you know, if we put the chassis this way
mm-hmm.
instead of just putting it here, and put them down some dolly track, as soon as we're done with the master, we'll be able to swing right over there and put the camera in position for
boom,
the
boom.
Close up. You know, and you've already started the lighting. You know, you're one ahead, and it allows you to. Be quick and flexible, you know, and still look like a hero to somebody.
Mm-hmm. We've got about a couple minutes left here, and you've been, again, so generous with your time with us, but just a moment on your family. You spent a lot of time away from them, but you've
mm-hmm.
managed to raise a son who's now, 21 or so?
21.
And,
mm-hmm.
and a daughter who's
18.
Very stable. How has your wife and your family put up with your being gone? And
well, actually, that was one of the things that I decided early on, and we sort of did. They almost always come on a location with me.
Oh, great.
They lived in London for the better part of a year and went to school there on Roger Rabbit.
Mm-hmm.
I've always, even if it cost me money, I would take them on a location, because to me it was important that not only we go through this as a family,
mm-hmm.
But the educational value to the kids, not just from what you might call the purely academic, but just the life skills and understanding people and being places and adaptability and learning to travel and all, has been extremely valuable. We lived in Mexico for 4 months on Romancing the Stone.
Uh-huh. Broadens their experiences.
Oh, yeah. And they have no fear about traveling, seeing people, living in hotels, eating odd food. I mean, we went on the African safari recently, which could be kind of intimidating, except that everybody was perfectly comfortable eating, you know, things that we've never seen or eaten before because of that. So it's been very important to me to do that, to make sure that the advantages I have, you know, they have. The travel that I've been able to do, they've been able to do. The experiences I've had, they've had. And, you know, and that's all part of, I think, you know, this the whole procedure going through life. And, you know, my wife supported us early on for, you know, 3 years while I was struggling
mm-hmm.
Achieve the dream, and I always got support from her, and so it's been very important to me that you know, this become a shared experience, and that we all do this together.
That's marvelous. Well, I'm going to say goodbye now. We're running out of tape. This has been a terrific interview, Dean.
Well, thank you.
Thank you for all your help. We'll just fade out here and see you on the set. Okay.
So long.
Bye.